This budget is addressed to 1% of India. This is a budget for the rich, by the rich, and of the rich. It's after looking into the number, we have discovered that this capital expenditure is an inflated number. Unfortunately, they're targeting the media, and many of you are simply bending before them.
After the budget, a deeper look by Mr. P. Chidambaram is something everyone looks forward to. People are saying that this is the first time government has shunned populism and has gone for growth.
If helping the people who have been affected for 36 months, the very poor, that is the bottom 30% of India, is looking after their interest, populism, very bad. Let my critics continue to say that neglect 85-90% of India and take care of only the 10% of India. Unfortunately, in this budget, not even the 10% has been taken care of. This budget is addressed to 1% of India. Never before in India's history, 24 months of a slowdown. For 8 quarters, GDP growth came down from 8% to 4%. That is a contribution of the Mr. Narendra Modi government. Declining GDP growth rate for 8 successive quarters. So 36 months the people have suffered, and you are telling me, go and tell the people, wait, nothing will happen. Wait for another 2 years or 3 years or 4 years, jobs will come. Is that the way a government, elected government and a democracy should function?
Why then this government has taken such a big risk? Because the kind of large borrowing it is going for is a risky bet.
The large borrowing is not because of large expenditure. The large borrowing is because of lower revenues. You're buying whatever the finance minister says in her speech without looking at the numbers. Where is the large borrowing? They borrowed an additional about 10 lakh crore, 10 and a half lakh crore. But of that 10 and a half lakh crore is really accounted for by the fact that they lost nearly 5 crore in revenue. Therefore, it is to fill that gap, it is to fill that hole they have to borrow. That doesn't mean there is additional expenditure. Out of 10 lakh crore, if you subtract nearly 4.5 lakh crore, what is left? Another 5.5 lakh crore. And the 5.5 lakh crore again has not gone entirely into capital expenditure as the finance minister made it out to be. Now we know that 3 lakh crore is simply a repayment of an FCI loan taken from NSSF. So that is not a capital expenditure, that is simply a book entry. So you minus that 3 lakh crore. So what is the additional expenditure they have done? My rough calculation shows about 1.5 lakh crore is the additional expenditure in a whole year. When they said we are going Atmanirbhar stimulus, it's additional 1.5 lakh crore. Will that create jobs? Will that get back the jobs that were lost?
First time government admitted that the fiscal deficit is 9.5%. So that whole discipline of FRBM Act of 3%, they have completely forgotten about it because they think it is a historic moment and we have to go for exceptional decisions.
FRBM Act has been buried. FRBM set a target of 3% of fiscal deficit. The fiscal deficit should never exceed 3%. The finance minister breezily says that by 2025-26, 5 years from today, when this government will not be there, she will not be finance minister, and she's setting a target for that finance minister by saying in 2025-26, our fiscal deficit target will reach 4.5. When will you reach 3? Another 5 years? Another 10 years? That is why yesterday two rating agencies have said we are seriously considering downgrading India's credit rating.
So government somewhere has decided not to get worried about rating agencies. That's why this new paradigm.
Government is wrong. The economic survey is wrong. The chief economic advisor is wrong. to say that what matters is debt to GDP ratio and the fiscal deficit does not matter is completely wrong. It's wonky economics, and the country will pay a price for this misguided economics.
What will this budget do to inflation and interest rate outlook?
Retail inflation is over 9%. Wholesale inflation is close to 6%. Why do you say we are in a good place? If the fiscal deficit is not contained, inflation will rise, which is why there is already talk about RBI increasing the bank rate. The bond prices have already gone up by 17 paise since day before yesterday. EMI rates will go up, borrowing rates will go up, and that will add to inflation. I don't see any way in which inflation will come down with this kind of fiscal deficit.
We are looking at a very, very bad days ahead. And while the general commentary via legacy media is that this is a historic budget.
What nonsense. Who created this legacy? You can't blame any other government. You've been in government for 7 years. You can't go back in legacy and blame the British, and before the British, the Mughal, and before the Mughal, the Guptas, and before the Guptas, the Mauryas. What is all this? You ruled this country for 5 years. You are ruling this country for the last 2 years. It is your legacy. You created this. You did demonetization. You did the muddled GST. You failed to discipline the economic management, the expenditure. You created this muddle. You took catastrophic decisions. And now we are facing with a situation. Which other country has had minus 23.9 recession? Every country has faced a recession. 2%, 3%, 5%, 7%. Which other country has faced minus 23.9? That is because you created this catastrophic situation.
They are saying two PSUs and one general insurance company we will privatize. These are all good news, sir.
Our industrial policy says we must have a competitive environment in India. They are privatizing a public sector bank and handing it over to the private sector. I have no doubt in my mind they have already chosen who will get the two banks and who will get the insurance company. I'm not saying nationalize a private bank. I'm not saying that. Let the private banks grow. If there is space for private banks, give more licenses. Why are you handing over a ready-made bank to a private sector man? This is my question. We have never said we will privatize public sector banks. We said we will privatize loss-making companies. We will privatize businesses where government has no business to be in business. We will privatize companies where the technology is overtaken, the technology available to the company, and new technology is not coming to the company. We will privatize these three categories of PSUs. We have never said we will privatize a public sector bank or a public sector insurance company.
Earlier, we always accused that they have been hiding data. This time, they have disclosed the entire fiscal deficit, 9.5%. Now, don't you believe their data transparency?
No, I don't. I don't. In fact, the budget documents printed by the budget division reveals more than the finance minister's speech. I think she wrote the speech without referring to the budget documents. The point is, we don't have hard copies. Even MPs of this country do not have hard copies. Should they not have printed at least 1,000 copies so that MPs get hard copies? It's after looking into the number, we have discovered that this capital expenditure is an inflated number. Tax and non-tax together, or tax, I think, they're increasing, assuming a 15% increase in the revenue. But if your revenues are going to, if tax revenues are going to rise by 15%, why is your nominal GDP rising only by 14.4? Mm-hmm. Why is your nominal GDP not rising much above 15%? Number one. Number two, the finance minister says nominal GDP, real GDP will grow by 11%. I'm amazed. If nominal GDP is growing by 14.4 and inflation is already 6%, how can your real GDP grow by 11%?
Every government wants to win the next election. Why would this government present such a bad budget, according to you?
They think just before the election, they can do some fireworks. Like last time, they had Pulwama and Balakot. 3 months before the election, or actually 2.5 months before the election was notified. They think that before the next election, they will have the Ram Temple, they will have the Central Vista, they will do some fireworks. They are not concerned about the poor of this country.
So this government, this ruling establishment, believes that economic performance has nothing to do with electoral outcome. So relax.
Yes, yes. Otherwise, how did they win in 2019? After demonetization, after GST, after a slowdown for 1 year, 2018-19, they still win an election in May 2019 with an increased majority. The economic performance should have packed this government home.
So, sir, agar ye halat hai, to isme to sabse badi responsibility opposition, mainly Congress, aapki party ki hai, ki wo is bluff ko call kare.
I pointed out that the numbers are wonky. I was the first to point out that the health number, 2,23,000 crore, or some fantastic number that the finance minister said, 2,23,846 crore, was a complete bluff. Then I pointed out that the defense budget has not been increased at all. I am pointing out now that your capital expenditure is a bluff. There is no capital expenditure increase at all. And I also pointed out that before she read paragraph 141 of her budget speech, which contains the fiscal deficit and revenue deficit figures, she read it at about 12:10 or so. By 11:32, Bloomberg had already tweeted the numbers. I want to ask the finance minister and the government through your channel, how did Bloomberg tweet the exact number at 11:32 a.m. when she read paragraph 141 at 12:10 p.m.?
Sir, by the way, Bloomberg...
None of you has got the courage. None of you has got the courage to ask this question in her press conference. Everybody attended the press conference. Why don't you ask the question? The White House press conference, the correspondents ask tough questions every day. When the Prime Minister of Britain steps out of 10 Downing Street, they ask him questions. Why don't you people ask the question, how did Bloomberg have the exact number of both fiscal deficit and revenue deficit at 11:32 a.m. when she read paragraph 141 only at 12:10 p.m.?
Sir, there is a disclosure. Bloomberg is our, we have a joint venture with Bloomberg, and our partners are very smart in news gathering.
I want to know how.
Okay.
I compliment Bloomberg on the scoop. That is your journalistic privilege. You have to scoop the news. I'm not saying you've done anything illegal. I'm only asking the government to tell me what kind of a budget secret you maintain. They are steel companies, cement companies, oil companies, power companies, construction companies. By invitation, they write in the newspaper. They advertise in the newspaper. If the newspaper writes anything against the government, government will tell them, don't advertise. So the newspaper can't write anything against the government. I have analyzed the newspapers. 24-page edition, 28-page edition. On Tuesday, they gave exactly 2 columns, 4 inches, including the headline, for all the opposition parties put together. Whereas each big businessman, each chairman of a company, got almost 2 full columns for the page to write whatever he wants to write. Obviously, what else will he write? If he writes anything else, the investigating agencies will be at his door tomorrow. So they will sing their praises. I don't blame them. They are living in fear. But I have no fear. And you should have no fear. The media should have no fear. Unfortunately, they're targeting the media, and many of you are simply bending before them.